like to present you a question which is not solved yet, and I will not give you an answer, but maybe I'll pose a question which is, let's say, in the process of solving. So, the first foundings in the Neria cave, these paintings from 42,000 years old paintings showed us already some messages. So people that time express and they draw something, what is this fish or some animal, doesn't matter. But they try to express and to tell something. We don't know what is the real meaning of these animals. It's a lot of theories, but let's take it as granted that these are quite modern drawings. We can compare with nowadays drawings, and we can say that it's very contemporary for me. And also we can see undersigned, that these drawings are undersigned. So these hands, we see two different types of palm prints, and that's usually for illiterate people normal that they do, let's say, fingerprints, and I will do the same today, as I know. We know this very old drawings from Lascaux. It's very beautiful and very narrative, but what is the real meaning of these drawings, we don't know yet. Maybe it's connected to rituals, but later in the end I will try to make another point of view on the same drawings. Later we have some clay tablets from Ashurbanipal, where we see that the story are they are telling us stories, different stories on pictorial level. And later on in Egypt, ancient Egypt, we can observe how the hieroglyphs represent this pictorial transformation to abstract science. So I just pick up few examples that you can compare, but that's our let's say development of our civilization, and it's a very important period of evolution of these pictorial drawings, which results afterwards in science. That's very well known, and luckily one foundation of Rosetta Stone, which did Napoleon troops in the 18th century, and this stone is very important because it was written in hieroglyphic on the top, ne? And this is also Egyptian writing, and bottom is all Greece. So you can see the differences in style, but what is important that this description gives us then clue what the hieroglyphs means, and that it is the language. It was afterwards obvious, and that it's possible to read and write with hieroglyphs. In between, we have also one clear example of Venus tablet and from Gilgamesh table, which shows us this abstract forms of science, no? In these blood tablets, and they are really nice. But let's move on. You know what does it mean, because we are in wine country, so anyone can understand that these presses are very old, such as screw press. It's all around Europe, you can see them, and in wineries, that's one very old. And that was probably also initiative or idea for Gutenberg's press. That's how maybe he likes wine. He got this idea, and that's his first press. And what is important with what happened with this press? For each development, it's necessary and it's crucial that it's possible to reproduct whatever between animals, humans, any business, whatever, plants. So reproduction is very crucial for each development. And in this linguistic sense and for grammar, that was essential, this Gutenberg's press machine, which gives us opportunity to, let's say, spread books, knowledge, and afterwards we have the university here and also Slovenia, because we have brought up people who are able to define the idea of Slovenia long ago. And also this linguistics base, or it's enough one-dimensional level. So why I mention this? Because nowadays we have a computer which represents something similar as Gutenberg's press, because it gives the opportunity to reproduce picture and color. Picture works on a two-dimensional level, and that's very important, because we have much more information between one picture. We know this metaphor that one picture is more valuable than 1,000 words. And but this story goes on also in three-dimensional words. So, but we are now in some kind of, let's say, process of developing this two-dimensional linguistics and grammar. And colors, in this sense, they mean this skin of whatever we see on the world. In that is our communication system based on colors. Actually, the colors does not exist. That's a problem, and that we know from Newton already. How this year ago, many hundreds. Centuries ago, but let's say the colors, we know that, that is only interpretation of the light. The light which comes in our receptor, and we have such monitor in cortex, so we can see the colors, and that's interpretation of energy, a different, let's say, wavelength, and so. And therefore, any kind of managing with color is necessary also to regulate with grammar. So we are now in a process to make, let's say, basement for the grammar for the colors. And that will be in the next century, let's say, decades. Maybe we should learn then, and we must learn then. Like reading and writing, we have to go to school, so it will be the same with colors. We will have to learn it, this grammar. And I will represent in a short, really short, this relations between relationship with colors and natural cycles, because the natural cycles they last millions of years, and we brought up in this system in ourselves, so we understand it. And from out of this system, we have all understandings. And I will show you this correlation now. Just simple daily cycle we have in all different, let's say, entropic area in, let's say, temperate or in polar parts, we have different attitudes towards the day cycle. Also, in the polar day and night, we know that there is no this feeling of day and night because it lasts half year, night and half year day. And in tropic, let's say, regions, there is no big difference between winter time and summer time, maybe more rain, but in the temperatures, no big difference. But you can see how many, let's say, how strong illumination from the sun to the earth. All the time, the sun is spreading its energy, and that's what we're receiving in different, let's say, regions. And it means during this day cycle that is, let's say, also symmetrical, and out of this principle, you can make some conclusions. So, the simplest conclusion is that we divide this on black and white, but in more refined, we can make vertical symmetry, and we can see that we have 12 different, let's say, energy levels. It's painted gray, but it doesn't matter. It's only relation to the energy amount which is falling on the earth. That's the day cycle, and the year cycle shows us something similar. We will see. We have five similar levels. So March and September, for instance, receive the same amount of energy from the sun, but we know that is the difference to be March or in September, while because the energy is also accumulating in the, let's say, this month, March. We are now just in winter time still, but that's why the energy has to accumulate, and during the summer time, in September, it starts to irradiate again, and so that's the surplus from this radiation from the sun, and that's the difference. And from this system, we can see we have here one general opposition between June and December, and that's this extreme distribution. So, if we make a simplification, so we can see that we have here 7 different, let's say, levels. So, from the sun, the earth receives some different, let's say, amount of energy. It depends when on trajectory it's earth, but it's important just, and I made it grayish, that you can see the differences. But March, September, February, October are similar, but we will see how it manifests in colors afterwards. So, in this simple division, we have this relation, blue and yellow. So, if we remember the summer annual cycle has on the one side June, and June is, let's say, light, hot, and the yellow correspond with this. And blue is in winter time, so it's cold and or less energy, and this symbolic goes together. Then we have green and red, which those who are colorblind, those who has troubles with seeing red or green on the semaphore, they see mostly the similar grayish. Because if I should show this in gray, you will see just a slight difference. So green and red are very close in this gray scale. And this system I showed you now with four colors, it gives you already two oppositions, four colors, and with each it's possible to express whatever. So in medieval, let's say, heraldry, use it this for let's say two knights for fight. They have to be in different colors. Mostly the people were at that time illiterate, and normally that was this distinction that they understand who is who. And nowadays is the same on the any sports game where you have to differentiate to club, no? Or football team or whatever. And also in this system we have some possibilities which are something what is more refined. But you can see that all these regions, let's say red is everything reddish, blue everything bluish. There is no interference between the colors, because you know if you are on the grass and if you make a photo and you have a white, let's say, shirt, it would be a reflection of this green. But this is in medieval art knowing as a local coloring principle, which we know and is like it looks like this. At that time, a lot of this heraldry, colors were used for signs and all these flags and so on. And they didn't use the colors as we understand them today. They silver they have for the white, gold for blue and so on. So in ancient Greece they have a name for four colors only. It's so for colors it's important that you are aware of the certain tone and then you can name it. So it's not just automatically that we have names for colors. And actually nowadays you know that we have on computer millions of tones, but we have not millions of terms how to define these tones. It's impossible. So colors has a huge possibility to express slight differences, but in this heraldic system we have the simplification of on these four different colors and normally black and white. So we have six afterwards. And that's the complete already, let's say, color body. But what is very important also, what is a unique feature of the color is cold and warm. That's the colors for itself, they have bisemantical value, so they can speak two different things at the same time. So they give you a color information and they can give you a form information. And that's crucial. So this simple system, we can correlate also with more advanced. So here we see the whole annual cycle, which can be divided. So in each level, we can divide on two different, like we have a month, we can divide them on colder and warmest. So we can then divide also in this system colors, describing so what is hot and what is cold, warm, cold. And that's the unique, let's say, possibility which gives us colors. And that's the background for the language also, which I hope that we will develop in this case, hopefully. In this relationship, maybe I should tell you that the colors are in a three-dimensional system. So here is only shown the equator of this system. So is missing here. It's up, it's white and black. So the whole system is already built with four colors. It's possible to build with four colors in black and white. And black and white is also, we know that is color, but achromatic, no? Doesn't matter. So we can get from this division from 4 to 12 different colors. We can make also more, let's say, divisions, but it's a problem how to make this distinction between few tones. Here, because they are together, you can see the differences. But if I spread this over the place and in these different conditions, lighting conditions, you lost then this, let's say, comparison between these two tones. So more the tones you have, harder it is to control them and to be aware of them. But for our purpose, for development of this grammatic for color language, it's crucial that we know all these steps. This is the basic, let's say, and the basic system with two opponents. And here we have the next system, which gives us a little bit more colors, with six colors. It means three positions, plus black and white, plus black and white. It's connected with angles, but that's more mathematical, let's say, or geometrical logic, which is incorporated in this system. But I would like to show you only a correlation between, let's say, I call it major angle system, which is, let's say, similar to the musical system, but it's not the same. I don't want to make this direct correlation, but I use these names because this major system gives you a little bit more rough combinations, and from division we get 8 color circle, the 16 color circle, and so from this angle of 60 degree we receive these three oppositions with much, let's say, richer color possibility to express, and that is also the next step with 12 colors. That's, for my opinion, the top we are able to differentiate afterwards, and I didn't even show the colors further on because I'm lost, and I think that the people would be lost. So I developed some kind of system of periodic color model. Periodic color model gives you some kind of possibility that in each cross section you have some kind of relation between the colors, and these colors you can evaluate. So this evaluation gives you opportunity in this grammar of that color organizing in the system of language later on, I think. And I will just briefly show, quick show these differences between a simpler system and more advanced, and how it based on this geometry. We can go further on, but it's no sense to go just to see the examples that you have idea how the complex the system is when we add any color. And here, with 8 colors, we can see that's much richer possibility to use the colors. So it means that we can define the let's say, some rules, some values to each of the, let's say, color, and we can measure it. And that's normally supported only with computer, with hands. It's impossible to control such a problematic. As you see, with 12 colors, it's very complex already. And actually, whole system, it's based on torus. What I was showing here is only one sequence from one system, but the torus is finally the real geometrical form and body where it's possible to understand the colors. Like continue. Here I would like to show you just this periodic color model in a sinusoidal graph, which shows you some correlations between colors and, let's say, with spring, summer, autumn, winter. We know that it's impossible to mix, let's say, the middle of the day with night scenery. We have this feeling in ourselves, so that's only, let's say, presentation how the colors and the colors orientation, what meaning has behind in correlation to this, let's say, cyclic system, natural cyclic system. So it means that we have in each, let's say, picture, we have all colors, but one is dominant. And with this system which I'm developing, it's crucial that we are able to manipulate with dominant colors, and we know what we want to gain. So we can project, we can analyze, we can do whatever with this system. And that is, let's say, final, let's say, scheme of the four seasonal color model, which based on this major angle pilot, as I showed you. And here you see all this, what, that's like a formula. You have this division of warm and cold, day and night. That part is related to this, let's say, list of meanings. Warm colors, positive, active, material. The warm colors behave like this, physical, more corporal, solid, hard. The surface is important, and they are visible and conscious. And in the contrary, we have with cold colors all these meanings, which are just opposition. But it means a system which gives an opportunity to evaluate something what we should we would like to do. So there are night colors, cold, negative, passive. But it doesn't mean negative in the sense of negative, but just opposition of positive. Negative, passive, material, spiritual, ethereal, amorphous, soft, unconscious, and so. But just to make an experiment, on black screen, you pose red and, let's say, blue on text, and you will see, everybody can experiment this, that red colors goes out, blue goes in space. So the blue colors is impossible to see precisely, and that's the easy to check the let's say this manifestation of let's say surface colors with, let's say, etheric and so spiritual more. No? And that is another model with, let's say, 12 colors, and all these correlations with months. I just made these correlations because I would like to show something for the end. Leonardo da Vinci made this Mediterranean man. This drawing is very important. Maybe that's the most popular drawing in the world. I mean, it's still in use, and people like it, and I see it in a lot of places. And he put like a formula, like a canon that man was placed in the center at that time in Renaissance. No? So man was in the center of the world, and so he captured in kind of formula, and that's it for Renaissance. And nowadays we are again in kind of Renaissance. That's the second Renaissance, which enables, we know that in the time of this primary Renaissance, we had invention of printing machine, then a lot of things happened. We had the perspective view, so it means it was invented space. And a lot of things we know what also Leonardo means in this sense. We have listened today because he has already, no, he has scientifically and artistically tasks, and we cannot divide them at that time yet. Later on it spreads to different. But I think that he is also a designer, one of the first designers. But in the next step, we know that in ancient times, the people, inhabitants, they have great interest in stars and planets and in the sun, normally, because they depend on, their lives depend on the sun. And in Egypt, we know that they have Ra and they have Set, so they fight night and day. That is a simple division. And also all religions based on this astrological, let's say, background, which is described in such a zodiac. And this animals just means a constellation between stars. But to remember, it's easy to make some drawing of something what we can remember. So maybe here lies the one way to interpret also these drawings in the caves, because I read some articles already that could be some interpretation how to, let's say, find the correlation between some stars, and so with different animals you can enable this, what they correlate. And I think maybe in the near future we will have a different point of view, let's say, possibility to understand these drawings from the ancient caves, what I showed today. But at the same time, you can see a lot of similarities what I showed you with this color, let's say, system, which is quite close to this very, very old gnosis, which are related to the stars, to this our solar system, to this cycling, natural cycling. And I think that here lies a basement for also development for color language. That's, I hope that I'm not too long. Okay, that will be, and that's this definition, like, let's say, background for, let's say, color grammar in the near future. And that's my, let's say, investigation. That's the end. So I just want to show you the complexity of the color system. And I done today didn't mention all this physical, let's say, background which lies, and so we have a lot of, let's say, parts which are very interesting, but let's say the interpretation and how to use the colors is only one small part which I should like that it will develop in the near future. But we have already, as you see there, science in let's say, traffic, it's already a kind of, let's say, language with colors and so on. But I think that like a linguistic spread from one Indo-European source, to many, let's say, varieties. Now we have to translate from one to another language, but we had one source. But colors are still in this, let's say, unique form that could be some kind of international language. I don't know how to, let's say, how it will look like, but I'm trying to do something, some background, some grammar ground to make it like international language, that we will understand through this color language each other here or in Japan, like in mathematics, the results in Slovenia has to be the same like in Japan. So, and that's it. Thank you.